And when you think back to how he came and how he sacrificed his life for us, and how he humbled himself to be born as he did, it really is amazing, and he is really truly worthy of all of our praise. He is our Savior.
Let's go. can we do like a letter to praise while we're having an offering ministry team? Ministry? We're used to that low key. But I think we got to begin to praise God for the healings. We got to begin to press in. I mean, no, that's rejoicing. And so can we do that? We do that. We pray for the sick today. So if you're sick this morning, or you just want to come up and just worship and praise God this morning. But we do want to pray with you. Please, man, and woman of God, pray with you. Let's believe what God is going to do and what God is doing in our house today. Amen.
Thank you.
conviction of God blessing him. We don't do that for that. But God loves us so much, he blesses us, but we are obedient to his word. And his word says to give. So, as we do our offering confession this morning, anybody get any checks in the mail this week? We did. We got one. Little dividend check. Hey, I'll take it.
I'm going to get the four lights.
Anybody
four
find any money? I did.
Found four lights.
Hey, every little bit helps. I don't know if anybody had inheritance, but I mean, believe it. If you believe it and expect it. Let me tell you, I want to give God praise for just found out that this past week, was it this week or last week, we broke Bob's throat. Now, we're glad you're with us, brother, because I'm here today, the day you celebrate your birthday. Here, he's still with us to celebrate his birthday. Hallelujah. Well, hey, man, God's got more for you. God's got more for you. You're still with us. So, let's give God praise and glory. We know with the baskets on the ends from time, from the middle, from the end of this month. Let me tell you, we have been able to bless so many over this Christmas holiday because of your giving. We just give God praise and glory for that. That, you know, there's families that are out there hurting in our family, our family body, and we're able to bless them and be a part of their life at the time. And I just give God praise for that because of what you guys did. So, do we have the offer confession up there?
Yes.
If not, we'll get on the back of the bulletin. There we go. Now, are we going to do this with expecting? Because if you do it with expecting, that means you're going to be excited about it. If you're not expecting, it's just a bunch of words up there. But if it's expecting, it's a whole lot more than words. It's a vision. So today, as we receive today's offering, we believe the Lord for
jobs and benefits. Prices and benefits, sales and commissions, benefits, service. States and
thank you.
your health. Where's Dana? Where's Dana? Oh, congratulations. Dana, congratulations on last yesterday. I heard about yesterday. Awesome, man. God was good. Well, next Sunday, we're doing a little party for our children here at this church. And I need your help. If you'd like to donate, I present it to the children so the parents know. Sometimes the children forget to tell the parents. And I don't want no child left out and everything. But we've done a thing and took a vote on it. The children did, not me. They'll do a gift, no more than $5. Boy will buy for a boy and a girl will buy for a girl. And then next Sunday, we're going to have some goodies and stuff for them to eat. If you'd like to donate something, you know what kids like to eat? Junk food. Come on. They don't like the steak or anything. They like the junk food. Kids do. Which I do too. I'm one of the kids. So anyway, next Sunday, we're doing that for the children next Sunday. And everything in the classroom. So if you would like to donate or something, wherever Miss Jean's at, she's over in the room already. You can let Miss Jean know or myself know. And everything, and if you have a gift you'd like to get for her, if you want to buy two, one for a boy, one for a girl, that's it's okay with me and everything. That's, you know, that's my heart as kids. We can't leave our own kids out. And I believe in helping other children outside of these four walls, because we should. And we are doing it. But this is a time where we need to help our children that's already here also. So thank you and God bless you. Being here and helping the children of Life Church. Thank you.
We have children or grandchildren, maybe not in church. We don't want to take away from this church, but next Sunday is a great outreach. Whether you have, all you have to do is pitch a party to kids, and they're ready to go. And bring them so they can go and experience fun in church, what God's wanting to do. Amen? Let me just ask, does anybody here this morning have a praise report? This one, and then?
Yeah, yesterday we had our 15th annual Bumpers Run, and this place was full of motorcycles. And the kids out here, you should see the smiles on their faces. This is something that we do every year. Thank you for the church hosting it. CLOU, it's a fine organization. What we do, we try to dispel the rumor and the stereotype that the 60s movies made the bikers thinking that we're all bad people. I mean, because we're just like everybody else. I mean, and we made one highlight from yesterday. One of these little girls had a brand new bike, she never had a bike, and she learned how to ride right here in front of everybody.
Okay. Anybody else have a praise report? Something happened with a ministry or an evangelist?
This past week, I had such blessing, and I don't know if you've ever had blessings from watching TV, but I listened to a talk show, and it's a swagger, but it's the morning talk show, and they call in, and I'm always, the reason I listen is because I'm amazed at the questions that people, just general public, call in about that they don't know about the Word. And it made me realize that people don't know the Word, I guess because they don't get in it and read it and study. But anyhow, this man called in and he said, I'm calling because of my mother. And he said, she just died. And but she loved to listen to this broadcast. And you could tell he was really emotional. And he said, I can hear her now saying to me, baby, you need to get saved. So he said, I need to know that I am a cowboy and I have a ranch in Tennessee. And he said, I don't have time for all that. And he said, I basically am not interested
saved, baby. He said, now I'm about 6'3". Big boy. But he said, that's what she called him. So then he went on to tell all that he had been through all week. His tractor broke down and his equipment's broke down. And it was just one thing after another. He went to drink his liquor and it was tasted awful. He poured a whole bottle out. He couldn't deal with that. He had always smoked, and every time he lit up a cigarette, he'd go into a smell of coffee, like he couldn't get his breath on it. So he threw in cigarettes. And so over and over, he kept thinking about his mom and what she was saying, and her two favorite songs would just go over and over in his head all night long. So he couldn't to be grateful, and he was ready to receive the Lord, and I was so blessed, because I thought, and the thing he asked after they prayed with him for his salvation, and you could hear the emotion in his voice, and he said, do you think that Jesus was telling my mom that her baby received him? And that's your thing, and I thought that was wonderful.
Change.
pocket. Talk about the change inside of you. God is doing some things. And there's something else I'm supposed to say. I'm supposed to say that I can't remember what it is, so if I'm learning a sermon, I'll send it guns to me. And we do a little rabbit trail there. Just know that's me. That's my brain setting in. So Father, right now in Jesus' name, I thank you, Father. I thank you for all that you're doing, Father God, in our midst. Lord, I thank you for your word that is truth, your word that is life. And I thank you, Father God, as we eat upon your word this morning, may it bring newness, may it bring restoration, may it bring fulfilling in our life, Father God. And Lord, I give you the praise, the glory, and the honor for it, Father God. Let us become more than hearers of the word, let us be doers in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Anybody done any studying on your challenge of revivals, spiritual awakenings? Anybody? I'm still putting that challenge out there. I'm still looking at myself. I got a book called Fresh. What was that book, Carol? Trail of Fire. I'm still fresh. But I just got it yesterday, so I'm going to get into that and start reading it. It talks about a fresh fire. It talks about. And I can't wait to get into it. And so I want to challenge you to look at those things. Let's get into our scripture this morning. Beginning in verse 18 of Matthew 1. This is how the birth of Jesus Christ came about. His mother Mary was pledged to be married to Joseph. But before they came together, she was found to be with child through the Holy Spirit. Because Joseph, her husband, was a righteous man and did not want to expose her to public disgrace. He had in mind to divorce her quietly. So now we want to hit on this verse today. But after he had considered this, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream and said, Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take Mary home as your wife, because what is conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. How many know the Holy Spirit wants to conceive some things inside of us? How many know the Holy Spirit wants to conceive revival inside of us? Expectation inside of us. And if you go on and read this chapter, and you go back over to Luke 2, and you see more of the birth of the story about the birth of Jesus and Jesus coming in this world, you know, as you read that, you think about different things. What do you see? You see wise men, shepherds, angels, manger, stable, the inn, Bethlehem, census, all this, the Christ, the child, you see all that, but there's so much more than just those things. And I believe that in this one scripture, there's a powerful word for the church that is hidden inside the story. And I think, I really believe with all my heart, this is for the church today. So as we read, as we had just read, we see that the Holy Spirit has come upon Mary, and she became pregnant. She was pregnant and would soon give birth to the Son of God. The Son that left heaven came to earth to die for our sins, which would be the key to bridge the gap between mankind and God. So Jesus is miraculously conceived inside Mary. And so the process of pregnancy begins. Through different setbacks and trials, Mary finally reaches the time of her delivery. And as her and Joseph enter to the Bethlehem to find a place to stay, they find that there is no, how do you know they didn't have call ahead waiting? You couldn't make reservations at the inn. So they come to Bethlehem. And they find that there's no place to stay, so they find a stable. And there she gives birth in Christ the child. And the stars shine above them. Shepherds and people came to see this child. We know that Mary was pregnant with who? With our Savior, our Redeemer, the Prince of Peace, the Lord of Hosts, and so much more. But church, we need to know that there is more. See, Mary was impregnated expectation of change. The one she was expecting to give birth to was bringing the greatest change that the whole world has ever known. And I wish I could explain it. But the Holy Spirit has birthed this expectancy of change inside of me. It's something I can't explain. I just know that something is happening inside of me. That God is bringing a change. The Holy Spirit is doing something inside of me that's making me more hungry for God. That's making me more thirsty of His righteousness. For what He has for me, this expectancy. Something has begun in my spirit that's saying that great things are coming and ahead and about to happen in Life Church of Monroe. That revival is building and that it's on its way. Something inside of me is telling me that. Something inside of me is growing inside of me, and I can't get away from it. You know, this past year, I began to speak on revival and building it up. And then I just kind of dropped it. Because I got to be honest with you, the flesh came in. Because I began to say, well, Lord, revival ain't going to come to us. I began to think of all these excuses why revival couldn't come here. Yeah, we have church people. Well, God, we got El Shaddai that comes and meets and everything. And one thing the Holy Spirit finally hit me said, revival doesn't have to be an every night thing at a church. It can be every Sunday morning. But then we live out revival the rest of the week. We get this thing that revival has to be these services, one after the other, after the other. But no, revival is in here. And it happens in here. But it's in here. And if it can happen in here, then it can happen out there. That's where the lost is. We're wanting the lost to come in here. And I'm going to tell you, they are going to come. But it's because what God is doing through us. And something has happened. I'm going to tell you, salvations are about to flood our doors. The sick are getting ready to be healed. The empty are getting ready to be filled. God is preparing Life Church, which is you and me and us doing something great. Amen. Listen, there are churches on every corner, seems like in Monroe and Union County. And since every time I meet somebody new, they're a preacher. Me and Jane went to Starbucks the other morning. I looked over and I saw this gentleman over there studying the Word. And I went over and I said, hey, give me the Word here. He said, yeah. I said, I'm new in the area. Just started a new church called Multiply Community Church. And they're meeting in the school. And so I'm like, yeah, I mean, I mean, somebody's a preacher. Somebody's starting a new church. What God is doing. So, let me tell you this. Guess what? There are still multitudes of people that are still lost and headed to hell. You can have every church on the corner. You can have a church in every school. But multitudes are still lost and headed to hell. It's amazing that we have all these great preachers on the radio, the TV, internet, I thank God. Coliseums are flooded with people going to see these evangelists. But still, the world is without the truth of Jesus. The scripture puts it this way. Having the form of godliness, but denying the power thereof. You can have the form, but the form without the power doesn't work. You just look good. There's no power that's taking place. I want the form of godliness, and I want the power of the Holy Spirit moving in this house, moving in each and every one of us. Not in here, but out there, when you're standing in the line of Walmart, when you're at the bank, when you're doing this, when you're frustrated, that God is still moving in you, and you are moving through God into somebody else. That's where revival begins to kick in with us. Having the form. And can I be honest with you? And nobody has any sharp you throw at me, okay? None of these religious activities can do what an on-fire, Holy Ghost, Spirit-filled church can do. Now, I'm talking about the kind of church that has learned the power of prayer and fasting. A church that preaches the truth without compromise. Christians who are not as concerned about, is the worship style right or wrong, but they're more concerned, am I worshiping? That's what needs to happen. That is the Holy Ghost on fire church. That's just one of the anointed. Now, everything's got to be just, you know, the way it's supposed to go. No, man, let's just worship God. Just worship God. And just fall deeper and deeper in love with Him. That's the kind of church I believe God is building here at my church. I thank God for the TV and the radio ministries. But I believe right here in this little town of Monroe, North Carolina, God is preparing a church for revival. There is an expectancy in my spirit that tells me something awesome is going to happen. And it's going to happen soon. And I say this with all my heart. If you can't feel the atmosphere of revival, pray until you do. And listen to my heart go further. If you don't want revival, please don't try to stop it for the rest of us. I love you. But let me tell you what's going to happen. You can fight it all you want, but God's going to do something in you. You can try to stop it, but the problem is it ain't going to stop in you. Because when you get into an anointed presence of God, change has got to come. And if you feel it, if you feel that revival, stay on course, because now all the outpouring of the anointed Holy Spirit power pack revival that's coming to Monroe, North Carolina. And I believe that it's generally in our life church. I'm speaking. And I'm going to share this with you. What God is saying to us about in this story here, getting back to the scripture here, in Matthew 1:20. You know, when Mary announced that she was pregnant, no one could believe that she could be pregnant as a virgin. So the first thing we see is she questioned it. Luke 1:34, how will this be? Mary asked the angel. Since I am a virgin, Joseph, her fiance, couldn't believe it either. In fact, as we read, he tried to break it. He thought about breaking the engagement with her probably so she wouldn't be disgraced. But if it was true, God had impregnated her with this miracle. And if I can be honest with you, there are thousands of people or more that who believe that a great move of God cannot or will not come here. I'm telling you. They're going to say, your crowd's not big enough. Your congregation ain't big enough. They're going to say, well, you ain't got much money coming in. We did. God has blessed us. They'll say, your church isn't that fancy. Doesn't have where all these big churches out. We don't have the multiple screens up here. We don't have the fog coming out. We don't have all this stuff that the big churches have. They don't say that. They don't say you have too many past problems. They don't say you really are not that technologically advanced. Because we have two little TV monitors. They don't big TV monitors, they're just a little small up there. Plus, you just don't have the right backing, and they can give us more reason. I guarantee you in here this morning, you can give me 5 reasons why revival couldn't happen in you. Well, my past sins. Well, I just got too much on me. Yeah, you don't know why I came out of it. Well, you don't know my parents were. Well, you don't have that. You can come up I'm just saying five, all you need. But I can tell you some of your reasons for revival would come here. One, there's no place too far gone that God would not bring a revival to. Number two, I believe there's some people that have been seeking God's face for a great awakening and a great move of God in this house. Number three, I believe there's some people here that want revival. Appreciate that, and I'm telling you, I really believe these people in revival because they've been here. Tony said, "Well, you've been here since the church is established." Vivian McAvick, Walter Turnbull, Carol still with us, brother. Stephanie, you didn't even know who she was here in the beginning. Bruce and Judy. Down to the they've been here. They have fought a good fight. And I believe they believe the revival has come to this place. They have seen the Holy Spirit fall in this place. And I believe that they believe that the days of revival are still here. Am I right? I believe that. And there's people here that's been here ever since I've been here. And you're believing revival is still in this place. We can look at these empty chairs and say, I guess people are right, the chairs aren't full. So God, when you get them chairs full, revival's going to come. Well, won't we just take all those empty chairs out? Then we can say, okay, all the chairs are full. No. When he brings the revival, not when these chairs are full. I believe that. There are always new churches to press in. And there are people in this church that is doing that. And because they are, I believe with all my heart, revival is on the way. 1 Corinthians 1, 26 through 29. Brothers and sisters, think of what you were when you were called. Not many of you were wise by human standards. That's me. Not many were influential. Not many were of noble birth. But God chose the foolish things. Any foolish things in here today? Of the world to shame the wise. God chose the weak things of the world to shame the wise. God chose the weak things of the world to shame the strong. God chose the lowly things of this world and we despise things and the things that are not to nullify the things that are, so that no one may boast before him. You know, it'd be easy for us to look back at the years gone by and be convinced that revival just couldn't come here. We haven't grown. Hardly no one has gotten saved. We've had some financial struggle. People have been discouraged. But listen to the words Jesus said in John 16, 21. A woman giving birth to a child has pain because her time has come. But when her baby is born, she forgets the anguish because of her joy that a child is born into the world. Church, we have had some rough years, but the Lord is about to give birth here. A miracle birth is going to take place. A birth of revival is coming to this place because we have the expectancy to change and go where God wants us to go. I am willing to change for God to do more. Another thing I see from this story, Mary was chosen because she was favored. See, the word favor here is defined endowed with special advantages or gifts. Mary was given favor from God. She was chosen specifically for this task, and God could have picked anyone. But she was holy, she was pure, and she was willing. The angel Gabriel told her that the Lord was with her, and then she was blessed among women. Guess what? God has identified those he has favored. It is those that are not full of sin, those who are willing to step into his will and then to go. Are we willing to step into God's will and go? Or are God's will and say, look at me, God. I'm in your will. But you're not doing anything he's telling you to do. Guess what? God has identified those that he has favored. Look at what Mary said in Luke 1:31. Be unto me according to thy word. And when Gabriel heard this, he just departed. And the point I'm making here, church, is just receive it. Just receive it because it's here. Open your hearts up and receive what God wants to do inside of you. Number three, the fruit will be blessed. Last week I read the verse where Mary read to Elizabeth, but I want to finish that reading now. In Luke 1:42, it says, in a loud voice she exclaimed, blessed are you among women, and blessed is the fruit of your womb. See, not everyone saw this child to be a blessing, but Elizabeth did recognize him, Jesus, as that. Church, the fruit of revival is souls being saved. Listen, these souls that will be coming into this house will not be cleaned up, good-looking people. Many are going to be poor, needy, desperate, smelly, drunk, drug addicts, street people, both male and female. I ain't talking about homeless. I'm talking about the street people. Some will be considered heathens of our society, but the thing is that these people are just like everyone else that is looking for the truth. The truth that will set them free. The truth that says you don't have to be that drug addict. The truth that says you don't have to live on the street. The truth that says you don't have to have that alcohol. The truth that says you can be more than you are. That is what they're searching for. And they're looking for a church that will tell them that. You know, I was told growing up, I said, man, you're a student. And at that point, they were telling the truth. Because I was doing some pretty stupid things. But when I came in to God, my father had never called me stupid. My father had never called me worthless.
Amen.
My God had never told me I couldn't do anything.
Amen.
My God told me I could do all things.
Amen.
My God said, you are somebody. You are an ambassador from heaven. My God says, I want to take you places. That's the kind of God I want. And that's the kind of God people need to hear about. They're coming here, church. And I can say as a pastor of this church, I say, let's bring in the sinner. Let's bring in the ungodly. Let's bring in the rich. Let's bring in the poor. Bring in those that need to hear the truth. The truth that's going to set them free. Let them flood the doors of this church and find Jesus.
Amen.
Let's love it. Everybody that comes in this church should get a hug and not just from me. You are the greatest greeters that this church can have. We should be greeting everyone. And let them know that they're loved by God. Verse 43 of Luke 1 says, but why am I so favored that the mother of my Lord could come to me? In other words, who am I that the one that is about to give birth to this miracle finds me worthy enough to walk into my world and want to be near me? That's what we're going to be hearing from those coming into this house. See, they've been pushed away by so many because so many are afraid that they might disrupt things in their service. These people might cost money. Look, they just don't fit in with us. Guess what, church? These are the kind of people that Jesus is looking for. Jesus didn't wait till I got cleaned up. Jesus didn't wait till I quit drinking. Jesus didn't wait until I got off the marijuana and the drugs. Jesus didn't wait. Jesus saved me right where I was, and he changed my life and took me from this place to this place. And now I'm a pastor of a church. Whoever thought a drunk and a drug addict would pastor a church? And if he can changed me, he can change anybody. If he changed you, he can change anybody. Because I know some of them were worse off than I was. You probably meaner than I was. And I wasn't mean, I'm just stupid. All right? Because I wasn't hooked on drinking. I wasn't hooked on drugs. I just liked doing them. But God cleaned me up. God saved me. And there's people out there that's walking in those steps. And I sure love to see that God changed their life. So we can have a church on every corner and still have people burning in hell. We are stating what God has prophesied over this church. Let me tell you, they've been prophesied over this church. For this church is the lighthouse. For this county, that people are going to be drawn to this light. But are we expecting what has been prophesied? I'm expecting, and I'm believing, a well of revival is coming forward to this place. I want to just quickly close with this. I was reading an article and it gave seven things that happen when you pray. And one, God hears our prayers. Listen, please listen. Every time you pray, God is listening. God doesn't say, I don't want to hear that prayer. Now, God listens intentionally to our prayers. God hears every word we pray. Do you ever wonder just how amazing that is? God has the power to transform our life from the inside out, and it comes through prayer. God desires for his children to pray not just for me, but I'm to pray for you. You're to pray for your brothers and sisters, for each other. And know this. It's not how you pray that is so important. It's that you pray that's important. We're going to have a fast in January. It's going to be January 5th through January 25th. Now, I'm not telling anybody what to fast. Because I'm going to be honest with you. With keto diets, with this, with that, I don't have any idea what people eat and don't eat. So, the fasting is left up to you, what you fast for those days. I am more concerned about you praying. Because if you're fasting, but you're not praying, enjoy your diet. Enjoy your diet. Hope you get to lose a lot of weight for your diet. But if you're fasting and praying, you'll lose that spiritual baggage, and you're gaining so much more heavyweight spiritual fight that God is wanting to do. Number two, time just seems to slow down and pray. What I love about prayer is that it has this amazing power of making things and the world, I mean, for the world to slow down. It helps us to reflect to when everything else is going by so fast. You know, when everything is just wow, 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 wow. And I'll see you sit down and begin to pray. See why everything just slows down. Because it's just you and God praying. You're talking to him. He's talking to you. Number three, we grow closer to God. Because prayer is our direct link to God. And talking to him just kind of brings us closer to him. And it makes us more in tune to his purpose for our life. Number four, we help others. We want to encourage people. And what's the best way to encourage people? Pray for them. I've said this over again. It's not enough to say, I will pray for you. Make sure that you do. And when you do, they will know that you love them as well as God loves them. And who are they going to keep coming back to? They're going to be coming back to you and say, look, we pray. And you're able to speak into their life. Because they begin to trust you. pray for our troubles, it kind of helps us to ease what we're going through. Because it isn't just you trying to get through your problem, it's now you and God getting you through your problems. It's not just me alone standing with my problems. I'm now praying to get God involved. And if God's involved, guess what? It's going to be taken care of. Number six, we just commune with the saints. Christians past and present, lifting up our voices to God in perfect harmony. I know that. Those that I know that go on meeting God, let me know they're rejoicing with God. And so when I pray, when I worship, when I praise, when I do all that, I'm in tune with them. And I said this before. How many of you believe that you can't sing the lick? Be honest, you don't want to be standing next to me when I'm singing. It might sound terrible down here, but when it hits heaven, it's perfect harmony, baby. Because everything's perfect in heaven. So, when I get to be in heaven, I get to be on the praise team. You don't want me on the praise team. Praise Him when we get to heaven. And we're going to be singing in harmony with love and perfect. And number seven, we worship. Praying to God is an act of worship. We're praising Him for all that He's done and all He's going to do. And I want to throw in one more here. Prayer helps us to expect what God is going to do next. Church, never think that prayer does not benefit you, because I'm here to tell you that it does. It's not a waste of time. And just say, Lord, I want to be more. And I want to do more. I want more. I want to be more, and I want to do more. Because, Lord, I want change in my life. And if I'm praying, I'm seeking God, change is going to come because I'm expecting it. But if I'm not expecting it, it's never going to happen. So we got to that place of expectancy. God brought a child into this world by the name of Jesus, His Son, His only Son, that helps us to bring that change inside. And when His work was done here on this earth physically, He went into heaven. He said, I'm going to give you something to help you out. That continue to change. I'm going to give you a comforter. I'm going to give you the Holy Spirit. And that Holy Spirit is down inside of us to help us to change. And guess what? He's given us some gifts to go with it. The Holy Spirit has given us expectation. Where there is no vision, the people perish. Where there is no expectation, the people will perish. But where there's expectancy, where there's vision, the people are going to flourish. The people are going to get revival. The people are going to move in my presence. The people are going to do something. Church, revival is coming to this place, and I believe with all my heart. I'm going to continue to speak in it and speak on it because I believe it. Now let's begin to pray. Listen, our prayer is going to be right where God. When we do our prayer and fasting, we're going to be praying for each other. We're going to be praying for revival. We're going to be praying for expectancy. We're going to be praying for what God has for this church. It's time. It's time. This church was planted here for such a time as this. We're going to have 2020 vision. You know, I look at these glasses and I look at you now, that ain't no 2020. All I see is a bunch of blurs. And it's kind of hard, you know, when I'm going down the road and I don't have the glasses on, I can't read the signs. expectancy. I can see the signs before me. Now I can expect what's ahead. But if we keep our expectancy off, we don't pray, we don't see God, and everything else is just a big blur. Yeah, I can see that right there. See the door, I ain't gonna run into it. I can walk around, I can help, and I can get down. Oh man, God is doing something. God is, I can see somebody lay hands on and pray for them. God bless them. I can get somebody a hug and know who they are. Because without my expectancy, they're just a blur to me. But now I can speak into them. I know who they are, and I know their needs. And that's why. How many of us have that same problem with these things? Yeah. The seats to the streets. I mission field. Revival's coming, church. And I'm so excited. All I know to do is to keep speaking it so we can get this out of you. You know, when my children grew up, I had to keep telling them no. But then we learned what no was. I had to teach them what yes was. I had to teach them how to do this, do that. So that's what I want to impart to you. I've got about a 50, 60 pound puppy at the house.
John
that's
Wick.
Far end of the day.
John Wick.
And all he wants to do is play. Listen, I love playing. I love playing. But there's times when I got to listen to God and be obedient to my master. How many know you can have fun listening and be obedient to the master? So, put your expectancy on. What's ahead for you? God got something great. Amen? Hallelujah. Yes, ma'am.
Okay, this is what God is saying to me right now. That in the last election, this church prayed. But didn't we expect? I honestly have to tell you that I did not expect Trump to win. And when I woke up the next morning and heard that he did, but we prayed, but there's so much more to what he's saying about the expectation. And it is just really, this is what God is telling us. Yes, we are a praying church, but are we expecting this to be? You know, just like I didn't expect Trump to be president, but he did. God changed that. That was nothing but a miracle by God. And praying for our country, praying for what's going to happen this week, what's coming before the Supreme Court, am I expecting God to change the hearts of the men and women? God says expectation is a major part of when we pray. Can I pray with you?
Yes, ma'am.
Father, we just take a hold and we ask you and thank you for the impartation of expectation from our pastor to us. Father, just forgive us for not Jesus' name. Impartation of revival. Impartation of expectation. Father, we thank you today and we declare that Life Church is the center of revival, is the center of expectation. Father, we're looking for the miracles. We're expecting salvations. Father, we are expecting the increase that you are going to bring in 2020. Father, we just give you praise today. I just ask you just to bless my brother, Father. Lord, his faithfulness, his determination. And Father, we just ask this blessing on him and his family. Lord, as his family comes in for Christmas, we thank you, Father, for protection, travel mercies. Father, we just give you praise and thanksgiving for everything you're doing in Jesus' name.
I just want to add something to that, that the Lord just put on my heart. We just have to stand on the word, because his word doesn't return void. And one of the scriptures says that the power of death and life is in the tongue. So what are we saying? What are we professing? We need to be doing the same thing the pastor does. You know, he keeps saying it and imparting it and saying it. Because in the New Testament it says, call those things that aren't as though they were. So we keep professing it, and we keep praying it, and we speak it.
Coming in to be filled up, so with you, go out and
fill up this world with Jesus. We want to do more, and we can do more. Lord, you are blessing Life Church for such a time as this. For revival is coming to this house, and we are expecting it. But we also know that it comes through prayer and fasting. It comes through the move of the Holy Spirit. And we thank you, Father, for all that you're doing in this house. Hallelujah. Father, as different ones are traveling over this holiday season, over Christmas, Father God, Lord, as people are out shopping and for gifts and all that, Father, I just pray safety upon them. And then while we're out there shopping, we can tell people about Jesus. And telling them about the greatest gift that they can receive. And we thank you, Father, for that. We love you so much. In Jesus' name, amen. Church, there's more. And God wants you to have more. I want to encourage you to pray. You hear the challenge. Go in and study about the great revivals. There have been 5 great revivals that happened in America. And one of the first revivals, I think like 1804 or 18, something like that, is that the church in Massachusetts is that they made an agreement that children of non-believing parents could be baptized. And that Baptist was saying that they were going to be raised up in the molds of the church. And with non-believing parents. But dear, revival breaks out throughout the heavens. The church can't compromise. The work of the world. So I want you to stay. I mean, you, 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 you,